So now what we are going to do, we are going to start the next session on screw jack, square threaded screws. Now I have not gone to the any other type of screws, I have only taking square threaded screws because for other screws mechanics is more complex. We are only going to typically consider, you know, where it is being used. It is used in, as you can see here, the jacks, you know, house jacks, press, then you have clamps. So all of these we are going to use the screw jacks. So we call it, typically we call it, you know, square threaded screws being used in jacks. If it is so, then we are going to say screw jacks. But remember, there are other applications also. For example, it is used for clamp. So as we all know, what is the purpose of a screw? What is a screw? Screw converts a rotational motion into a translational motion, if you think of the motion. Similarly, it converts, therefore, it converts a torque into an axial force. That's the basic concept. Remember, what would be important here is that what is the pitch? Pitch means that is the distance between the two threads. And what is the lead? Lead means if I make a perfect one revolution, then how much vertical distance it will move. So that's the lead. So these are two important aspects. Okay. So with that, now how do I come to the mechanics of it? How do I draw the free body diagram and try to solve it? Remember that here is the screw is on a base. There is a cap, and let us assume that the friction between the cap and screw is ignored for the time being. So I have load, so I have to really either raise the load, so it is mostly used to raise the load. However, depending on the amount of friction you have, we can also make it self-locking. We can hold the load and so on. So it is again a question of raising the load or holding the load that we have to keep in mind. So the question that comes into play, that I am trying to, let's say for the time being, raising that load. Remember the contact between screw and base. So here is the contact, that's the main contact I am talking about. And this is happening along a portion of their threads. So you have a base thread, you have a screw thread. So this interface is going to be critical. That is what the delivering the friction. Remember, I have to apply a load P, that means in the handle, a torque is being, you know, a load is being applied, this force P is applied, such that it produces a torque, and that torque will be converted to an axial force mostly, so because it is going up and down, okay? So ultimately, what is happening, if you think of it, we can simply unwrap this inclined plane. Let's say you think of this base, right? There is a thread on the base. How about if I unwrap it? It makes it inclined, right? How it is going to incline? But based on the pitch and the lead, going to be inclined. So 2 pi r, if I open the amount by 2 pi r, vertical distance moved is L. That is the lead. So the angle will be tan inverse L by 2 pi r, okay? So you will have a lead and you will have a 2 pi r, that's the revolution, where r is the mean diameter of the screw, okay? So remember, therefore, once I unwrap the base, ultimately what I can do, I can take the screw, like the load coming onto the screw as a block, you know, on a block. Say block, as if a block is on the inclined surface. Remember, this torque is now, we have to take this torque as an equivalent force that is coming horizontal. So if we go to the next slide, we'll see that what is happening exactly. So the unwrapping the thread with a lead angle of theta, right? So this angle will be called theta. Now how I have unwrapped it, remember this is going to be 2 pi r, and if I unwrap the thread, then the vertical distance moved is L, right? Remember L and pitch is not same, just be careful. Lead and pitch will only be same if it's a single threaded screw. So if you have single threaded screw, the lead L is exactly equals to the pitch, where pitch is the distance measured between two consecutive threads. Therefore, now as I was telling that what is this equivalent force Q that is trying to raise the load up the inclined plane. So therefore, this entire friction force, as we have learned that friction force is independent of contact area, although it is for a simple friction, that is the assumption we are deriving if we skip the tribology of it. So therefore, what is happening, you can clearly see that I have now, during the impending motion upward, that means when you are trying to raise the load, so therefore, when we are trying to look at the motion of this block up, that means we are trying to raise the load, screw is trying to advance on the upward direction. What is happening during the impending state? We can clearly see that this coefficient of friction, from that we can calculate the angle of friction, right? Why this angle of friction is coming into play? Remember, impending motion is upward. If impending motion is upward, the friction force is downward. So what is this resultant? The resultant between the friction force, maximum friction force, that is mu s, and the n is the normal force. So ultimately you can construct that force triangle. I have a n here and I have a friction force here. So n goes like this, right? And friction force comes like this. And so friction force and n, that gives me a resultant. And q is the equivalent force, remember, that is coming due to the torque. So q equals to, or q multiplied by r. So at the interface, if you look at it, I have a horizontal force, right? So that horizontal force multiplied by r is actually equals to p times a. So that torque is being converted to this horizontal force, that is as if helping the load. Load means the load that I am trying to lift, it is really moving on an inclined plane, where this inclined plane is determined by what? Determined by the thread angle, right? The lead angle rather, okay? So ultimate idea all the time will be, for a given W, how do I find out the Q? Clear? So for impending motion upward, this is my going to be free body diagram. This was done also from yesterday's lecture, right? So we have, once we find the Q, I should be able to know that what is the force P. Remember, I am lifting the W at various strokes, so that is assumed. Giving some stroke, it is simply trying to lift the load. So I am trying to determine that what is the force required such that there is no slippage at the threads. Okay, when I am trying to, so this is for impending motion upward. Now remember, now you can easily think of what happens when the impending motion is downward. Downward means that load is just trying to come down. Okay, this verge of coming down, so I am just applying a small force. Again, remember, when I want to, you know, lift the object or, then I have a larger load. When it is trying to come down, that is lower the load, then I have to apply a very small force, P. So when the impending motion is downward, as we can all see, the two situations can happen. Remember, when impending motion is downward, what happened in the process? my friction force is reversed. Which direction is the friction force? On the upward direction. So if you will think of the force triangle, where is my resultant now? So depending on the coefficient of friction, right, I have the friction angle already defined. So if I put here F max, where F max is nothing but mu s times n, n would be the normal force. So the angle between the friction force and the normal force, that's my friction angle, right, that is phi x. Now depending on the value of the friction force, this phi s can be, or rather depending on the coefficient of friction, this phi s can be smaller than theta or greater than theta. Now here what we are saying, it is smaller than theta. So if it is smaller than theta, then remember again I will be able to solve for a q, and that q will be ultimately give me the value of p, and that p will be much lower than what we have done in the previous case when you are trying to raise the load. So when we are trying to raise the load, I have to apply more force than compared to when I am trying to lower the load. Now what is self locking? You can see that you may have to apply, if the friction coefficient is really large, it's such that your friction angle is greater than theta, right? So resultant of the friction force and the normal force, as you can see, that will make the resultant, which is actually on the left hand side of this vertical line. So in other words, phi s is greater than theta, so coefficient of friction is large, okay. So in that way, what we have to do now, you have to maintain the equilibrium of the body, I have to reverse the q. So that means instead of applying the torque as we are doing in the previous case, we are applying the torque how? Counterclockwise, right? The torque was applied counterclockwise, so force was this way, perpendicular to the handle, right? Then you have to really give a clockwise torque, so we have to give it a clockwise torque to actually lower the load, okay? So now can you tell me, when we don't need the q, when q goes to 0? Q goes to 0, now that's very critical. So q goes to 0 when r is collinear with the w, that means phi s equals to theta. Now that really brings in one very good point. What does it state? That when q equals to 0, r is actually collinear with w. In other words, phi s is equals to theta. That's the critical angle of self locking. That means I don't need to apply any load on the handle, and I can always find the minimum load that will be sustained by the screw. The screw is not going to come down automatically. So it is completely determined by the coefficient of friction, and when that angle of friction becoming theta, I can say that that's the critical angle for self locking, as if I have to apply no load q, right, and the body will be able to sustain some load. Is that clear now? So three situations as I explained here. That first one is the raising the load. Just to raise the load, what is happening? Remember, friction force is this way right now, downward, friction force is downward, therefore resultant is moved this way between the friction force and the normal force. The other case is impending motion downward. Now that can lead to two situations, when you are just trying to hold the load, and in another case the friction angle is very high, therefore you really have to apply a force, right, that is from the other direction in order to lower the load. Now, can you have a brief discussion? Is that concept is clear now? If you just buy this simple mechanics logic, now you can approximately solve some of the problems, really challenging problem, using the concept of threaded screws. Yes, so just few questions I can take for discussions on only the threaded screws, square threaded screws.
1060, go ahead for your question.
Sir, I got doubt in belt friction, sir.
Okay, just go ahead quickly.
Okay, sir. The sliding friction will act when the tension is maximum, sir. So, what is the direction of sliding friction? When the tension is maximum, the sliding friction is on the maximum.
The friction force, right, in the impending state, whenever you have an impending state, friction force has achieved its maximum value. Is that clear? Friction force will achieve a maximum value when it is at the impending state. That means the body is just trying to slip out. Okay. Now, how do you determine the direction of the friction force? Is that what your question? Think of it. In the belt friction, I have this drum. Just look at my hand. If I put a cable, right? And let's say cable is trying to tilt this way. So, from your direction, it will be counterclockwise, right? Then your friction force has to be on the resisting that motion, right? It is trying to resist that. Therefore, tension side will be always this side. Higher tension side will be this side, lower tension side will be this side, because that negative friction force should be equals to the other one. It's equilibrium, but you can't take just sum of force along x equals to 0 in this case. Think this way, that this tension has to be higher because resistance is going this way. Okay.
1026, go ahead for your question.
Good afternoon, sir. So, regarding your presentation in the first session, first problem, to lower the load or to keep equilibrium, the force required is 181.15 Newton. At the same time, to lift the load upward, it is 132,811 Newton. There is a drastic change in load required for lowering the load as well as lifting the load. Is there anything wrong in the answer, or that much of force is required to lift the load?
So, your question is, just don't think about the number. Just think of physically that why do I need a large force when I am trying to lift an object up, and when do I need a very small force when I am trying to hold the object? When do I need a very large force? When I am trying to pull the object up, because there is a friction force that is resisting, right? Think of physically. In one case, the impending motion is upward, right? Another case, impending motion is downward. You think of in simple sense, if I have to lift the object up, I will always need a higher load. If I just have to hold the object which is trying to going down, I will always need a very small load. This is intuitively think it out. That number that was put in the first problem is absolutely correct, because it is controlled by the friction that is coming into play. There are so many wraps and all that. So, those wraps are taking care of those friction. But point is that when you are trying to raise the load, we have to apply really large force to overcome all of the friction effects. Right? Okay. But when I am just trying to hold it, that means this mass is trying to coming down, I just need a very small force. Okay? So, just physically thought it out with the free body diagram. Okay, thank you. Screw jack problem is clear, because I am not getting screw jack questions. The screws concept is clear, it is a block on an inclined plane, that's all we said.
1205, go ahead.
Sir, my question is, during relationship of T2 by T1 is equals to e to the power mu theta, we choose the fixed pulley instead of having the motion between the pulley and belt. And the same is regarding belt drive, we are having both motion between belt and pulley.
So your question is, during the derivation, we have used fixed belt on a pulley.
No, sir. Fixed pulley.
Does not matter. Suppose I have the pulley and I have the belt, right? The way I have solved is that this belt, the belt is trying to slide in some direction. It is still not slipping, but it is verge of slipping. So I tried to find out which direction my tension will be maximum, because there is a friction force. If it tends to go this way, then friction force is this way, right? Okay. Now, based on that logic, I derived the formula considering the impending motion. Now, remember, the same was done during the simple friction problem also. F max equals to mu s n. How did you go to that? So, what happens? I will just again explain it, why it is like this. See, the basic concept is as follow. You are increasing this value of P. So, P value is increased, right? So, you will have a friction force. So, you are trying to break this barrier of friction force. There is a maximum friction force that will be controlled always by this N. N is equals to W in this case, let us say. Okay? So, we are really going here. Keep on increasing the P. Friction force will gradually increase. There is a barrier point. We call this, that is the maximum friction force that the body can take. What happens afterwards? It simply drops, right? And then we say, okay, I have a kinetic friction coming into play, because when you have, motion is already created, then I need actually very small force to move this block forward. But see, my point here is, I am only interested in, okay. Now, this part will resolve the block under motion. So, up to this one, I always have the equilibrium. And this one, I am going to have the dynamic. That means, body will be either in acceleration, right? Then I have to really equate P minus F should be equals to, let us say, mass of this block multiplied by acceleration. Okay? So, we always derive the formula at the impending state. At the impending motion, I will always derive the formula. And I will simply can say that the same can be used when we are talking about the kinetic coefficient of friction. Remember, kinetic coefficient of friction comes into play also for constant motion problem. Okay? So, that is the whole idea, that we first get the impending motion and then they just substitute the kinetic coefficient of friction to get the same formula. But remember, kinetic coefficient of friction, when we are using the kinetic coefficient friction, two things can happen. One is the constant velocity problem. Right? One is the slipping, actual slipping that is taking place. So, when the actual slipping is happening, we are always going to use the kinetic coefficient of friction. When there is no relative motion, then we are always going to use the static coefficient of friction. Okay?
Okay, sir, thank you.
Yeah, go ahead.
I have one doubt related to the belt and pulley system. At our domestic flour mill, sometimes foreign particles are entered between the belt and pulley. So, the effect of efficiency of the system decreases. So, can you suggest me some considerations to increase the belt, the system efficiency?
Your question is, how do I increase the efficiency of that system? Do you remember that problem we talked about regarding the idler pulley, introduction of idler pulley? See, you can increase the contact angle, that is one of the options. How do you increase the efficiency? I have only choice is to increase the contact angle, so that will increase the torque transmission capability. Now there are other ways, I am not getting into that, so that requires more conceptual, you know, understanding, but simple way would be increase the contact angle. Okay?
Yes, yes, thank you, sir.
See, there are problems here, but I think this problem, once we understand the, you know, block on an inclined plane, these problems can be tackled. So I had one problem in the lecture slide, and all of you should have the lecture slide in the Moodle. Okay. So in this problem, you see, we are using the clamp to hold two pieces. Now the clamp, only thing is that we have a double square thread of mean diameter equals to 10 mm with a pitch of 2 mm. Okay. Now, if a maximum torque of 40 Newton meter is applied in tightening the clamp, determine the force exerted on the pieces of wood. So, we are interested in finding out what force is going to this wood as I apply a torque of 40 Newton meter. The another one is the torque required to loosen the clamp. So, maximum torque is one part, the another one is the torque required to loosen the clamp. See, in one case we can think, once we are tightening, then you are trying to actually raise the load, that is the first part. So, we are trying to raise the load in one part. In other one, we are simply trying to hold the load, right. So, loosen the clamp. So, in loosen the clamp, will be again, you can think of that whether my phi s, that means the angle of friction, is greater than theta, lead angle, or less than lead theta, that is less than lead angle. Okay, so the concept is similar to what we have studied. So step by step, if you want to go ahead, calculate the lead angle. Okay, and as I said, that lead will be twice the pitch for a double threaded screw. And then we can simply use the concept of block on inclined plane. Okay. So that will solve for the first problem, first part. And the second part, we can again use the concept of, you know, impending motion downward, and that will solve it. So I will try to flash it very quickly, the steps that are required, because as such answers are very simple, these are very straightforward problem. So first, find the theta. Tan theta equals to L by 2 pi r, and here you can see L equals to 4 mm. Why the 4? Because it is 2 times the pitch. Okay. Then we can calculate the friction angle also. Angle of friction was calculated, angle of lead was calculated, right. Then ultimately I had to find out this Q. Remember, Q multiplied by R, that should always be equals to the torque. So, what is the value of Q? Q times R, mean diameter, that is equals to the torque. So, I get the value of Q. Okay. So, now therefore, what we have is, in this case, if you draw the triangle rule, you know, just use the triangle rule. This is theta plus phi s, right, we can get the value of W. Similarly, when the impending motion is downward, remember you want to loosen the clamp. Now remember, to start the problem, first we have found out that phi s is greater than theta. So, phi s is greater than theta will create a self-locking mechanism that we have already discussed. So, therefore, if you look at the resultant will be shifted this way. And Q will come from the other direction. So, you have to really apply the torque on the other direction. Okay. So, with this, then you can again calculate by based on the triangle rule, we can find out what is the torque. Remember, every time you are doing this problem, it is a body with three forces, right, and they should be concurrent. Okay, so that is the concept. So there are three forces which are concurrent in nature. Now you can also do sum of force along x0, sum of force along y0, that is also the possibility. Okay. So, but triangle rule would be more appropriate to solve this class of problems. The other problem, I am not going to go through it. Once we understand this concept, you can also think of, you know, more practical applications as you see this kind of problem. So, the automobile jack is being lowered or it is being lifted. We are applying a torque here, right? So, we have to find out the torque to raise the automobile. Let us say we have an automobile here. So, that is 4 kilonewton, you know, load is coming out. So, we want to find out the magnitude of couple required to, if we want to just raise the, try to raise the automobile. So, again impending motion condition comes into play. Now, remember the thread direction is different in this case. In one side I have this side right handed thread, this side left handed thread. Okay. So, ultimately as you apply the torque, A and C point will try to come close to each other. If you apply a counterclockwise torque, then it will try to go away from each other. So, in one case you will raise the load, in another case we are going to lower the load. That is all. Remember what would be the first step in this problem? To get the force transmitted in the screw. And that you can do because these are all two force members connected. So, if you use the two force member concept, we can find out what is the load that is coming in the screw. So, this 4 kilonewton will be converted to an axial load along the screw. That is the whole idea. And once we get that, you can draw the free body diagram. From these free body diagrams, one can get what is the load coming on the screw. Okay. So, once you know this load, so this is going to be now applied. So, this is going to be the applied on that block. So, now you are going to the block analogy. So, in that block, this is now my FAC. Okay. And then you can see that to raise the load, we can again try to find out the lead angle is found here. So, that is done, right. Then you have the phi s. Phi s is the angle of friction. Okay. So, based on that we will be able to find out the value of q, right. Once q is found, we should be able to get the moment. So, only thing, this moment, this torque is one side. So, remember you have to multiply it by 2 times because you have taken only FAC. So, we have solved the problem from one side. Okay. So, we have to, the final torque that is required is this. Okay. So, point that I am trying to make, so this is going to be same as that of our simple friction concept that we have developed yesterday. And based on that, I can always, you know, calculate, let us say, what is the torque required to raise a particular load or to lower a particular load on a screw jack. Okay.